There are two main approaches to building a model: hypothesis-driven and data-driven. We discuss in this video the broad lines of the two approaches. Given a data set, we may take two fundamentally different approaches to understanding that data set through modeling. In the first, we have some additional knowledge or a hypothesis about the model type that should explain the data. This may come from additional knowledge about the phenomenon described by that data, or from previous experience with similarly looking datasets. So right from the beginning, we may know that we will aim to have, say, a linear model or a quadratic model, or whatever other hypothesis we may have. We may even have more than one hypothesis, test all of them against the data, and select the one that best explains the data. In the second approach, we have no clue about the type of model that to be given as a solution. We only have the data set, and we are willing to accept pretty much any kind of model as long as it explains the data well. Some practical constraints may be in place, such as those related to how complex the model is allowed to be, but the form of the model is quite free to choose. In hypothesis-driven modeling, the modeler has a hypothesis regarding the mathematical form of the model she is building. It's just a matter of finding the numerical parameters that make the chosen model explain or fit the experimental data best. Some deviations are going to be willingly accepted, and the main technique here will be on fitting the model to the data, finding the numerical setup that brings the model predictions closest to the data. The emphasis in this approach is entirely on the model. On the other hand, in data-driven modeling, we have no a priori hypothesis regarding the mathematical form of the model. The modeler is strongly guided by the data, and the aim is to capture the trend of the data to predict in between the data points. The emphasis is almost entirely on the data. Here is an example. Let's assume we have a few data points like this. If we took a hypothesis-driven approach, where our hypothesis is that the data to be explained is by a quadratic model, then we may well come up with a curve like this. And this overall is quite close to the data points. On the contrary, if we had no hypothesis and we were only guided by the data points, we may notice that there is a change in the shape of the dataset from a concave curve in the beginning to a convex one in the end, and we may come up with a curve like this. In all of these considerations, we accept as a starting point that there may be errors in our dataset, and we include this in the modeling processes. We will thus accept imperfect fits, and the aim will be to minimize the deviation of the model from the dataset. A legitimate question is, where do errors come from? And here are a few sources of errors in modeling. Formulation errors may come from the fact that any model will ignore variables that have an influence over the behavior. This is done for many reasons: incomplete knowledge of all the relevant variables in the phenomenon under study, an explicit decision to focus on the main aspects of that phenomenon and ignore others, even though their influence may not be negligible. Relations between variables may be ignored or simplified. There can also be truncation errors coming from various mathematical techniques used in building the model. Unavoidably, the model will be built with finite precision just so that it can be handled by a computer, and that may introduce errors into the model. There will also be measurement errors, imprecision in the collection of data, physical limitations of the instruments, or even human errors. Taking all these errors into account means that we will accept imperfect fits of the model to the data, since the data itself is always imperfect. The focus will be on getting a good enough, as simple as possible model explaining the dataset. The meaning of what is a good enough model or what is a simple enough model will be discussed later in the course.